Ladies and gentlemen, we're back in time for game four. And by the way, I was able to figure out how makeup works in the break. Do have the TSM logo now. It might be actually showing up backwards. No, it's actually showing up properly. Beautiful. Oh, I did it backwards in the mirror because I thought the mirror would make it backwards. So I did it backwards to try and mind game it, and it worked. Boom. The C9 logo is still not really drawn the best, but we actually have both logos again. So great. We're ready to get into this game and see game four. Game four. Match points still for TSM if they can pull out the win in the North American NA LCS. Let's see who becomes the best team. Currently,
there is a chance.
TSM up 2-1. Good play by Cloud9, but it was a really close game. And the first two games that TSM won, they were not close. So let's see if they can keep that up. Now, TSM gonna be banning out the Fizz. Very good adaptation here. That was the first loss for TSM. This is the first time they've needed to adapt the bans and not just go with standard kind of power picks here.
Also do think
Rengar the Blanc, very strong, very worthy ban. Fizz is a little unusual, but again, because that worked out for C9 last game, and Fizz made Hanser's life hard. In fact, did really good on Fizz, very good ban adaptation. We finally see the Camille ban coming out. Even though they won that game, and Fizz did make Hanser's life a lot of trouble. If the Fizz is banned, banning the Camille makes sense. This might be what they consider to be their pocket counter pick. Again, every single game, I think, we've seen the Lulu first pick coming out of TSM. Even when there was that insane pinch on the top lane champions from all the bans going to top lane, they still picked Lulu first. And again, you know, I think I said last game, I think that the Lulu for Smoothie was the most powerful pick, most powerful champion that game. And I think Lulu had been on Cloud9 most games. If I'm correct, Jack can correct me on that. But Lulu, every time in this series we've seen her, has been an absolute monster. She's just been played to utmost perfection, and it's been a clinic of how to play Lulu to save people and prevent deaths and give just that slight bit of an edge and an engage that you need. So it's great to see that pickup get such high priority in the pick ban phase from not just Cloud9, but TSM as well, going to first pick it. Absolutely great to see. Good deny. That way they don't have to use a ban on it. They can only adopt the one ban with Fizz, and they can just snag the Lulu for Biofrost. Great. Also, we're seeing them pick up Ivern
in the early game, or even at level 6, because he just demolishes.
It's interesting to see that with the opportunity, Contract still opted to go for Graves over Ivern,
because they can put him on any type of carry and give him a ton of support. Now with Orianna,
but this is okay. This is something we need to talk about
from TSM. Is it
for a couple reasons? One, there's a whole bunch of enabling right now, right? This is a Lulu support. This is an Orianna mid. This is an Ivern jungle. All those are pretty clear. Lulu has shields and her ultimate and her speed up. Orianna has a shield. Ivern has a shield and like a makeshift gap close. And he builds a whole bunch of utility support items. This is going to enable the hell out of whatever ADC they pick. Their ADC is going to be a monster. They might even pick a top laner who's like a very aggressive top laner, like a Fiora or even Aurelia is not aggressive enough, like a Riven, you know? I would not be surprised to see that kind of aggression come out of top lane if, in the second ban phase here, what's banned out are your hyper carries that work really well in the composition like this. Kog'Maw. Kog'Maw. And Kog'Maw. I'm very much expecting to see a Kog'Maw ban come out of Cloud9 is what I'm trying to say here. Especially since they've already picked up their ADC for the match, Ashe. There's no reason they shouldn't just throw both of their bans at the AD role. Now, to try and prevent counter picks, I mean, Orianna is so well-rounded. There's not really a super clear counter pick to her very unique playstyle. She's well-rounded, so there's no real accentuated qualities that require other qualities to be downgraded in how much they can perform. So there's not necessarily ways to exploit her. As such, I would expect there not to really need to be a priority to pick a mid laner here to prevent target bans going to the mid. I would expect this to be a support pick to prevent target bans going to the support. Because again, you can pick a lot of things into Orianna. Having initiative over what support you pick, or maybe even a top laner, but I would be surprised if it's a mid laner. Even though it is standard to do more of like the answer picks.
TSM has no intention of picking something like Kog'Maw or Twitch.
Interesting, they might do Aurelion's Soul. Aurelion's Soul wouldn't have been banned out.
Yeah, whether you're playing a top lane carry or a top lane tank,
Syndra might have been banned out.
Like this can supercharge you.
So that's actually, if there was going to be somebody you were going to pick up, it would be a Syndra, because that's a very, very strong pick right now. But with all of these shields and heals, I'm a little skeptical about the Syndra pick, because instead of enabling the hell out of the ADC, what they could instead do is say, well, okay, who did Syndra just target? Well, we're just going to give them a whole bunch of shields and heals, and now Syndra can't 100-0 them anymore. We'll see how that works out. We're seeing the Karma come out as the first ban for TSM. Again, they're definitely going to pinch the ADC pool, not at all surprising. I am surprised a little bit to see Caitlyn come out as the first one. I'm very much expecting a Kog'Maw ban. I will be shocked.
There it is.
No, remember, I have not seen these games before. Karma and Nami pinching the support pool. Not picking the support here allows that to be pinched a little bit. It's kind of the same thing though. There's not, because right now you can't really tell what the bot lane is yet. You just know Lulu's involved in it. So knocking out a couple other sustained champions, range mage sustained champions, kind of puts pressure on them to go towards a like less lane dominant champion. Lulu with her picks and the glitter lance damage actually does have a lot of presence and lane early. Okay, so they're going all in on the Lucian here, because this is not going to bring out any damage for Nautilus. It's just more setup, more peel. Ivern's not going to bring any damage. Bjergsen will, but Bjergsen also brings utility. And Hunter, or excuse me, Biofrost on Lulu isn't going to bring any damage.
Love it.
Good. Interesting. Okay, we'll get back to that momentarily.
To play, but it says his team won't let him play it. Well, in the deciding game potentially of their season, they're letting him play it, and they use it as a trick in this ban phase.
That totally worked. So I just assumed that was a Gragas stop.
He just smashes me on support.
Let's throw away whatever I was going to say. This is the clear highlight of this pick. I thought for sure that was going to be a Gragas top. So did all of you if you haven't seen this before. But then the Shen comes out, and that's a Shen top. And now we got the Gragas. So
that said, the amount of CC now that is threatening that Lucian.
There is.
If you can connect a body slam on Lucian, knock him in.
Flash taunt.
You have Shen taunt.
There is body slam. There is the Gragas ultimate. The slow even from the normal Gragas Q.
And your AD carry ever dies. The composition falls completely apart.
We'll see how this all works out. But here's the thing, too. You got to remember, it's not a Kog'Maw they're enabling. It's a Lucian. Lucian is very close range. He likes to get in there and really be skirmishing in the thick of it.
This is a pivotal moment in this series. Not just
I'm not expecting a lot of action. Actually, going to pull the goes back. They're not just stylish. They're also calm. Things will pop very quickly.
This is the strength that was supposed to be there for C9, the bot lane. They're going out here with a risky pick with
that
Gragas.
I just can't believe they're showing the confidence. It's either going to work or it isn't, right? In the bot lane. Pinching that support pool means that there was less available. And instead of picking something that's very traditional and but has a bad laning phase, like a Braum, for example, not the best laning phase at all.
Also have to question whether or not TSM
definitely about his team fight abilities in the mid and late game with being able to proc his stun on multiple people, being able to land a knock up on multiple people. But that does seed the early game a little bit. And if they're going to pick somebody who seeds the early game a little bit, why not make it somebody who's a little bit unconventional? So you can both bait a counter pick that no longer applies. And you can get something that they maybe haven't practiced against very much. And I'm assuming to pick it out on a stage this big, Smoothie has to have had a lot of practice on Gragas. This is not something that they would just whip out for the sake of doing so. I love that dance animation. You don't just whip out Gragas because it's half fun. This is the World Finals. This is the North American Finals that send them to the midseason invitational. This is their game point for their side. So they are not messing around here. This is something they have practiced. And I'm interested to see how this goes. There's not a super unconventional start. Ash, because there's no sustain coming out for her, is going longsword. Whereas since there's no sustain coming out for Ash, but there is sustain from Lulu coming out for Lucian, he's going to opt to go with the more aggressive Doran's Blade start. That means he's going to win the trades even more heavily, which will accentuate the lack of sustain Ash has coming out for
teams all year long, and now in this deciding game,
you got a rookie of the split.
The
split.
Three rejuvenation V start for Shen is actually fairly meta at this point. Just to bring himself some extra lane sustain, which all he has as a resource to manage is that health pool.
We'll be pretty healthy with Gragas and his
with the grasp of the undying.
Sustain, he also has the biscuits in his inventory.
Some additional health pots.
Targon, so just trying
that
to
be
not
plenty
get
of
level 2 on. Probably going to happen
should
though.
Should be just
TSM
fine in lane.
Has the push advantage.
And first he'll build those into be able to shoot a Tiamat.
She waits it out, so
that will eventually become a Titanic Hydra. So it's all along his build path. Fairly standard starts. Having an Ivern and going for something that's pretty normal as far as starts go is almost sub-ideal. This is very interesting to watch Contracts invade so deeply right now.
And we didn't talk about the Ivern mind games as much early on in this one because he's doing for a full field of turtle.
Oh my god, Smoothie goes back in for a turtle already exhausted.
Good engage there. Notice how he gets the autos off to put the keystone onto both of them. Contracts, seeing that this red is prepped, has to make it happen. But he is able to come over there and just clean it up. Powers of Ivern, very strong at just securing a camp that he's already started.
Really nice work from Sven.
I mean, look at that channel time.
Was
so
able to secure that. He'd already channeled
it doesn't take long at all to clear that out. Contracts spend a little extra of his resources and help him manage trying to deal with that. Wasn't able to make it happen. Good pressure. And that is one of the drawbacks to Ivern. If you go for a more standard start, if you don't pressure them with that invade style Ivern, you're going to have to deal with a counter invade. Or I guess they will invade you, rather, and try and mess up your timing. As you prep a certain quadrant of the jungle, go out to the other quadrant to clear it, and then come back to that quadrant you just prepped. They're going to try and capitalize on that gap between that timing window and try and counter jungle you a bit.
Ash
got
the
vision out there.
But Sven Skaren had the faster finger.
Does make sure the door is safe.
Very standard in tank play.
Yeah, it certainly has been something that's grown in popularity.
Gonna
so
go ahead and
much.
Do a little invade
power, especially on someone like Nautilus, who actually put out quite a bit of damage.
Since Nautilus was on top, he's not able to make a gank happen.
That's kind of the frustrating thing on Lucian. Every time we try and do something,
good trade
like,
so far. The sustain is mostly burnt through on both sides.
How risky
of this
that is when he
good
body slams
from
in
Jensen
for these trades because if an Iber
wow,
is there,
really good trade since he walked
back
into that last ability.
Smoothie probably would have died if he would have been there. So. Needs to trust that vision control they have in the river to make plays like that.
Contracts right here should know, though he can't see it. He can see how soon this was prepped. And he should know that Svenskeren is either in this brush right here, or had just walked out of here. To see that this was so low, I think it was about here when he saw it. There can't be, Svenskeren can't be very far from this scuttle crab. So it's he knows that there's an opportunity for a
this
counter
could get
game
turned
here.
Around on them if Bjergsen wants to try to bait. Ivern's coming in from behind.
Doesn't get stunned. Jensen
can't quite
just
get it.
Barely not getting that down. And here comes Sven.
Svenskeren comes out. I'm not sure about picking this fight here because he's 2v1 for so long before Bjergsen can join. And Jensen's Syndra is so much stronger early game.
Kind of move back in, but Jensen
he does have
the
to flash away, but in doing so, he forces
does
a flash
out
of Sven.
And no one dies.
And this is the tricky thing about playing Ivern against Graves, is Graves just demolishes you from close range, and that ends up happening a lot. So, unable to make that kill happen for Svenskeren.
Oh, aggressive again, but Turtle going to dash in and try and get a kill.
It's better for the mid lane, for the TSM. Oh my gosh, no way! What?! What? He was out of range that whole time? Are you kidding me? Oh my goodness. Okay. So look at this piercing light. Beautiful piercing light. He hits both of the enemies with it. And they both flash. And just barely does he stay out of range. And it's because he's now in the brush. TSM's Wild Turtle doesn't have vision in here. So he would have to walk all the way in here, which means walking through a volley from Ash that comes out, right? And then another auto attack before she breaks the fog of war here. And by that time, look at how low he is. Wild Turtle would be dead. So he's forced to turn back in an auto smoothie. And in doing so, Smoothie's too healthy right now. He just trades with them. I'm not so sure Smoothie necessarily needed to flash there. But I mean, hell, they are already burned all four of their summoners to just the two for Sneaky. So just burning one extra to secure is fine. They'll still have Exhaust up in the next fight.
Through a Gragas, the slows from the barrel as well as the body slam flash at the very end. Secure this kill. We're going to watch it one more time.
Just look at how disruptive Smoothie is. And the Stoneborn pack healing here is actually pretty big. As Turtle commits forward, Smoothie just go.
Yeah. So look, the Stoneborn pact has been consumed on both of them, it looks like. Or at least off of Wild Turtle. That's 100% what keeps Sneaky alive right now. Biofrost flashed first and didn't get the auto off. That's a mistake. Biofrost should immediately auto-attack and just take it. And if he had done that, and Wild Turtle was back here, while Gragas was here, if Biofrost just takes the auto here, and takes the kill here, rather, with an auto, Gragas is still far enough away from Wild Turtle to where Wild Turtle can slightly disengage and stay at a good range advantage from Smoothie, and Smoothie would have to focus Biofrost as he disengages because he's not going to get that kill. But because both of them flash, and because Biofrost tried to hand over the first blood to Wild Turtle,
right there,
they just don't get it.
The body slam flash, finishing him off.
Three flashes used pretty much simultaneously right there, the slimmest of margins that prevent first
so
blood
crazy.
From going over to TSM.
And look
such
at the
a close play
now on top of that. So when you're already down on farm and then lose out on a kill like that, it can be very tough because
that's
the Gragas is pretty tanky wait. Innately and now has this gold
we'll
protection.
Wait until Ash gets back to lane to see how far this farm differential has become. But you can just see it in the item advantage. She has Cutlass and Boots and he has
contracts with why
he's missing
a bunch of health. But
that lane until the next back is going to be abysmal.
His turn at this gank.
And then Impact actually hasn't based the whole game yet. He's just sitting on that triple rejuve beat.
Good job, Smoothie. Fine if he's just... And again, we talked a lot about vision. Here's a nice line of vision right here. The first dragon is an Infernal Drake. Great. Get that wall of vision established so they have control. And there's actually Ward right here too. So they have this kind of vision. That's insane to have that much vision this early in the game. And that should mean a free dragon for
farming
them.
Farming under his turret. But if he does get caught out...
And they even take out the scrying ward, or the scrying plant, so they know that there's...
It's so tricky to kill a Shen almost at any point.
There's no counter vision.
So the triple Thorns versus triple Rejuve, the fact that he's even on CS, makes that actually a great job by Impact, because normally the Nautilus out-pressures pretty heavily.
And the other thing about it is you're looking at a triple AP topside for TSM.
They can assume that there's a ward back in try here, just because of the way they rotated.
Simply because it means a top lane tank.
They rotated
buys a cowl, he's now pretty much immune to death from those three.
And one thing to note too, we oftentimes say, oh, well, Nautilus does nothing. He has no actual damage potential. Well, this is true. It's important to note that because of the changes to Nautilus, his only control of the wave early game is through his E, and because of the changes to him, he needs to have more mana regeneration than normal now to compensate for those changes and actually be able to still control the wave with his E. So what we see coming out of him is a triple Doran's Ring start just for the regen. But what this does is it makes it so there's a lot of AP on Gragas right now, or excuse me, on Nautilus right now. There's a lot of AP coming out of him, and he will do some decent magic damage as he just upgrades these like couple of items into the middle of the game. He's going to still have all three of those rings and be putting out a decent amount of damage. So you can't completely neglect the magic damage coming out of Hanser. You definitely can't neglect the magic damage coming out of Bjergsen, since we see the Frost Queen's Claim item for Lulu. You can't completely ignore the magic damage coming out of her, even though she hasn't spec'd into a lot of it with her masteries and she's not going to build a lot later. In this like mid-game skirmish points when they're fighting around dragons, this is a lot of magic damage that's coming out, and Svenskeren's Ivern is going to be putting out magic damage as well. So you got to be careful. You absolutely have to be careful with the magic damage. It looks like a composition that doesn't really do much.
Exactly.
Outside of
he's
really late game Orianna shockwaves and wild turtles
skip the armor
damage and going all in on wild turtle being able to just be a nightmare
in.
And carry everybody.
An swing in this lane because the Shen does eventually outscale the Nautilus in that lane.
But that Orianna is going to be the linchpin with the Ivern that can pull people in. It makes everybody a ball delivery system on top of Hanser already being a great ball delivery system. On top of Svenskeren himself being able to run right in. Hell, Daisy can run in. They wait for the blue buff. Great, they get it, and they get to transfer over to Bjergsen as well, who gets a nice refresh on his blue. Great. Denies it from Jensen, Syndra, which is really important.
Into a Shenton. It's a ridiculous CC chain you can pull off.
Yeah, and TSM hacks the wave in a pretty bad spot right now. Wild Turtle either goes down another
remember,
10
the Ash ultimate,
or he risks
the
death.
Shen
so
taunt,
this C9 bottom lane really applies
the ultimate
a lot
to set that up
game.
From Smoothie.
Level six. Also got no flash, so Turtle's a pretty good target. Stun again
with
by Jens.
Coming
the
in.
Maybe come with
his Shen's going to bolt in as well with shield and make sure that... Oh my goodness, the flash taunt. This is exactly what we're talking about.
Taunt him up and there's the kill for Jensen.
Impact knowing when to go. The ultimate for the mid lane fight, then flash taunt to get the max
man.
Range close on him right there. Beautiful.
So, ulting in just to make sure that any return damage comes out is fine and they're not going to get hurt. But also, in that off chance where that exact scenario happens and he just barely lives through both the Orianna lives both through the Syndra ultimate and the Graves ultimate. And just barely makes it out alive, Shen can always flash taunt. And that's exactly what happened. That is why the teleport comes out. Not just from wanting an assist, not just from wanting to make sure that Syndra didn't take a lot of damage during that fight. It's because it still secures in those corner cases. Oh, man. Insane. Look at this replay. Almost immediately, he comes. It's only after. Only after the stun hits. But basically, immediately after the stun hit, he just ults Jensen and just knows he can flash taunt there. And remember, Orianna took barrier this game and we saw her use it there? That's why you gotta have that extra bit of damage there just in case, because that Orianna will survive a lot with her E and her barrier being up. She's gonna be surprisingly tanky in the early game, and it's gonna take a lot, and that flash taunt is exactly the extra little edge they needed. Man, what a good play. So they get the Infernal Drake off the back of that.
Being proactive with the Shen ultimate.
You see how many wards teams are willing to out here? On that, so they invested a lot of vision in this area.
It's so much better set up when you do it like that.
Yeah, and the last from the time that Bjergsen was dead on Orianna, they have great. So many fights. They have free time on the dragon to establish that vision control, on the Drake rather, to finish that vision control, establish that vision control, and then finish in order to enable with those shields. But the more and that is going to help Jensen a lot. Jensen on Syndra is nasty. For anyone who hasn't seen Jensen play Syndra, it's really, it's something else. I encourage you all to tune into his stream.
And you're still doing early, you're going to be smiling.
We can see the he knows how to push that champion to its limits. With Ghost, he can make sure that he's in range all throughout the combat, prepping his balls where he needs them. And now that he's got a kill to his name, wasn't first blood, but still now that he's got a kill to his name, that's going to accelerate him further. It's going to make this build not feel nearly as delayed as it actually is. Because he's got both the MR and the Lost Chapter for mana regen and just survivability. That's a very slow start for Syndra, who wants to go something like a needlessly large rock first item to really unlock her potential. So this is a very cautious build. But getting that extra kill on him enables him to sort of accelerate the cautious build, where he's going to bring out the level of damage you would expect from a Syndra who's going to more hand needlessly large draw build. And with that vision control that they set up for Dragon, or for Drake, they're trying to like utilize that for a secondary purpose, get some extra value out of that by looking for bushwhacks around. And they're further extending that even deeper. If we look on the minimap, we don't need to pause right now. If we look on the minimap, this is the ward line right now. They have spent so much time around Dragon this game.
He needs to charm them so he can get the experience for free without smiting.
And it's showing. You know, they have really good control.
He's willing to expend smite because he doesn't want to waste his health and mana to prep a camp just to have it get stolen away by someone he can't see.
They have really good control over Dragon. They were able to make those plays. Unfortunately, missed the hook there. But it's not going to matter too much in top lane.
There's not much.
I mean, look at that. There's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 wards in that one quadrant of the jungle, which does mean that they're vulnerable to be taken advantage of elsewhere in counter jungle. But Ivern isn't the best at counter jungling because after the first smite goes off with his passive, it actually takes a while to get the channel and like wait for the initial timer to go down. So counter jungling isn't what they're about. What they have to do is try and take turrets. So they're all going to recall, try and give solo gold on the wild turtle. But I'm not sure if Impact is going to be able to stop that or not. We see the good damage coming out on Jensen. Going to get bolted from Shen. So again he can taunt him. Oh my goodness. All the plays. So they didn't finish off the top turret, but because Impact had to ult Jensen to make sure that that kill came through. Because as you'll notice, Orianna did have the barrier. Where's my draw? Orianna did have the barrier there, so they needed that to finish her off. She decides to save it. Another good taunt there. Good Gragas ult there. We're seeing the utility of that coming out in these team fights. It looks like they're going to be able to disengage. No! Biofrost going to get picked out by the Graves. Wow. Woo! That was a close one. But they do get a kill out of there.
You dive the AD carry, and then you itemize full MR as the Shen. No one could touch it.
Oh, man.
So tough for TSM. Even in this early stages, Cloud9 continuing to build themselves
An advantage
up to about 3,000 ahead.
It seems like if they can suppress Lucian and keep Lucian down, it's going to make itemizing a lot easier and it's going to make their team fights a lot simpler because their tanks are going to do a lot more. But Lucian, you see right there, that's just how hard Lucian is to get. You know, he's very slippery. He can dash out, making the Gragas ultimate reposition him more safely, and then he can stay on the outskirts and just barely make it out alive. He can pull in his own retreat path.
So he needs to have success.
He's certainly not doing like fantastic right now, and just having that discrepancy in the farm is making him like feel less impactful and is putting him significantly behind to where he might slowly become a non-factor in this game. But he's going to be rotating around. Like, TSM knows that this is happening. So they're going to make sure that they give him the priority like he's been getting. He's been getting solo time. He's been getting solo farms. Anything that stacks up has been funneled into him. And they're trying to compensate for that disadvantage. Of course, the same thing is happening with Ashe in the bot lane. They're trying to match that and keep that discrepancy large.
And impressively for me, they're doing it again, continuing that swap. You'd think.
Here comes the arrow.
Here comes the Ashe. Just barely gonna miss the result, though. Jensen does hit the stun, but it's unfortunately too close to the turret.
Barry's good in an all-in, but if you're CC'd, it's not
gonna matter. Nice little brush there, just in case he gets some cover. And they're just pushing topside really hard. So that it sacrifices control over this Cloud Drake. But what it does is it shifts the control. Because we remember how strangleholded this quadrant of the jungle was. By Cloud9, they just had absolute vision control. So TSM says, okay, we're going to just all rotate top then. Maybe we can't kill Shen, but we're going to have really strong control over this quadrant of the jungle. And we're going to pressure the turrets as hard as we can and try and make the most out of that.
Just taunts while Turtle buys time for his team to get hit. Jensen on a very long flank path does back away from
Impact manages to defend it for now.
It wasn't even close.
Pushes them off. Having Smoothie rotate up top also helps reestablish control over that quadrant of the jungle, so he can actually use some of the charges from his Sightstone there. He has a couple control wards in his inventory. He can break out if they really need it.
I just love the game plan and the
Impact not too worried about the harass from Wild Turtle there. But remember, Impact did start out with MR because the lane matchup, he was nowhere near Wild Turtle, who's the only physical damage in their composition. So he was purely itemizing, and his runes, I would venture a guess as well, were also magic damage heavy and low on armor. So trying to keep Wild Turtle paired against Shen is going to be a very effective matchup for TSM.
It's not like Svenskeren is on Lee Sin and behind, but you kick someone in. The playmaking from Ivern is essentially hitting a root caller. That's about as good as it gets.
Graves is invading right now, so to try and secure this blue buff with Gragas.
It's about offense. You can play offense, good, you can play defense.
Sense.
We know
the
TSM
be
was
aware of
playing
the
offense
spawn
in the first few
are.
Games, and C9 wasn't that great defensively here. TSM needs to play defense because C9 is in a great position to take an offense.
We're going
to
try and take this outer turret to bench them for it. And seeing that, Graves is going to rotate mid to equalize the Orianna, keep her pinned mid, which allows Syndra to come join Shen in this bot lane defense. And maybe try and defend this outer turret while the bot lane from C9 gets solo time on the outer turret for TSM. So maybe they can't defend this. Maybe Graves just sort of denies himself a blue buff there of a counter jungle. But it allows time in the top lane to where this will be answered. And
not feeling safe.
An opportunity if they overextend a little bit here to get punished with Syndra. Unfortunately, nothing comes of it, but they are going to be able to secure this with solo gold for Sneaky, keeping all that local gold funneled into Ashe, which again accentuates this gold differential even further. The Svenskeren redemption comes out, but it's not enough when you got Graves in the game. Graves does that. Really good play there, but I'm not I'm honestly less impressed with that because Graves just Graves is strong. Graves is really strong. That's why you pick Graves.
He does that. Where he could not come out on top on stage, and even from games 1 and 2, where
and unfortunately that was through the barrier too. So barrier is not going to be up for a while. And because they still had control over topside, as they were pushing down this outer turret, they're still going to be able to rotate and take this blue buff. And no less, they got it on the Jensen, which is great.
Yeah,
so that's a good sense to say, okay, I'm getting all in here, so I need to just try and return damage. But there's nothing much more you can do about that. He was the reason he was walking so far forward. This is a really weird camera angle. I can't show this effectively. The reason Orianna was walking forward like this at the very end of that shot was because Svenskeren's Ivern was like right here off screen, right? And he was trying to get close enough to where they could use Trigger Seed and try and keep him alive, but that extra sustainability just couldn't make it out in time.
From his team, the Ash Arrows that are being shot there. The kills all came when he was getting ulted by Impact and making aggressive plays on a Bjergsen, but when
and now Orianna is Jensen, severely behind so in this game, right? She's keeping up surprisingly well on farm for how long she's like spent dead. Those death timers early aren't as punishing, but nonetheless, like she's had a really good rotation time and again to compensate for that under farming.
Even just to deny it from your opponents is always very, very powerful, and especially for someone like Syndra, who is.
But that's really manifesting. That difference is really manifesting itself.
Massively stronger than if you do say 90%
in the bottom lane.
And then Infernal can.
I'm surprised by how much Shen is getting out farmed. By Nautilus.
Does feel like Svenskeren has had a
Shen has been all over the map quite a bit with those ultimates, but I would have expected that to be a lot more equal.
Impact does have ultimate, and I wouldn't be surprised if Contracts flanks with it.
Sneaky, there's the ultimate. Oh my god! Okay, so Sneaky opens up with the Ash Arrow, which stuns long enough for Smoothie to use the Gragas ultimate to pick out the target, which was Bjergsen of all people. Oh my god. Okay, so now they're not only chunked out on the ideal targets, they're in turret range from all the heals. This is what we talked about in the champion select, the Lulu ultimate, the Lulu shield, the we didn't talk about the barrier, but that didn't come out here because it was already on cooldown, the Svenskeren redemption and trigger seed. All of those shields were needed just to keep Bjergsen alive. So sure, he doesn't die there, but everything they have is down. So all of this is free damage coming out now. That's such good chase too, coming out of Smoothie with the belly slam. So they are able to limp away. Beautiful shockwave there to try and actually re-engage. Impact goes in the front to try and focus attention on him and keep it off the backline, who got surprisingly low there.
Certainly would have been a kill.
Whew, man, that was close. For how far behind they are in gold at this point in the game, TSM is playing this really well. And they are applying a lot of pressure to Cloud9. If you just saw that fight and had no context of the game, you would think that this was an even game. And that was just a really good engage by C9. Which it was! That was an amazing engage! Look at this! Look at this Ashul! Look at that! And into the Grogs, they chained it into his belly slam even. So great! Incredible play there. And Bjergsen, if he was a human and not Bjergsen, he would be dead. Every other Orianna in the world, like maybe not Faker, but like if we're not talking people who are going to be at MSI, every Orianna dies there.
It didn't look like could go many places.
And isn't around to get that ultimate off, which is almost a kill. Oh, those little corners, it didn't amount to a kill there, but it very easily could have. And those little tiny advantages here and there are what can make the difference in one of these upcoming fights and turn it back in TSM's favor.
Also saves his life when he gets hit by the Ash Arrow at the start of the fight, so definitely you can see the need for those Mercury tricks.
And again, TSM just continuing to play a little bit far behind. That seems to be the trend.
Oh, up here looking for a fight. Wild Turtle is the focus, but the shield's going to keep him nice and healthy. I'm not quite sure about that ultimate from Smoothie. It was to try and divide them up here. And as we look at this, it actually did really successfully divide TSM's team, which theoretically allows them to pick off anyone from these three. But they fractured themselves a little bit here by not really deciding which one they wanted to go off. Contract's only way he doesn't get a kill there is through the exhaust. Really great exhaust by Biofloss there.
If they have to base, C9 should have priority on it, and they're already starting it up.
But that does give them the fire break. So that's one of the major benefits from playing that so aggressively.
Yeah, makes
is even if you don't get a kill off of that and you wind up burning a lot of cooldowns somewhat prematurely, it pushes them so far back across the map towards the west that you have initiative over the dragon. Oh my god.
I don't know what he was doing there, but Jensen told him he's got assistance once again, and C9 might even get the mid-outer turret.
That's
a tilt. Huge
on
the map.
Bjergsen is just never safe from this bot side. Full vision control.
I don't know what's happening, man. Bjergsen.
C9 on this dragon side.
I guess he was going forward because he wanted to get the ultimate off there and try and get Jensen, but early game like this, Orianna ultimate just doesn't have the punch behind it. So, okay, he tried to sidestep when Jensen threw the ball onto him to dodge some of the damage, but like there's no way to play that right. That was just great sense by Jensen to all in
the only contribution to that kill that he gives.
Well, enough for him to secure.
And now Jensen's hit that stride. We talked about the really the strange start to the item build. That has been completely mitigated. Jensen is 100% on track. The regen has now been built into Normicon. The MR has now been built into Abyssal, which is going to shred the MR and make him even more lethal to everyone now. Nobody's completely safe on TSM from Jensen at this point in the game. And he's just got so much AP behind it already.
Carry that is that
even without a single item that builds out of needless yet, he has so much damage behind it.
5,500 gold up. Bjergsen does get a blue buff for himself, which is nice, but impact is continuing to be a thorn in Haunter's side.
It's a good adaptation for Bjergsen. This isn't super uncommon to see on Orianna, but to see both the Merc Treads and the Haunting guys come out just for the extra survivability, it's going to cover the penetration largely. It's just going to make there be a little less AP behind it.
Because they'd be able to get the Baron afterwards.
And they're moving that vision now from the bot side up to top.
Oh, man. Bjergsen's just not having a good time. That Orianna is going to not be impactful for a long time in this game.
Like Shen engage. You have so much stuff that if TSM ever gets caught out, they're going to lose the Baron.
I mean, well, turtle looking bot, but they tried to kill Impact. Just as soon as the commentators call it, look at how positioned they are. Lucian came bot to try and support.
Yeah, with luck.
Pushing off Shen, but he walks through vision. He walks through C9 vision, so they know. Just all in. Immediately just all in. Who cares that they saw? Stay on the Baron. All in the Baron. Take the Baron for free. And what are they going to do? What are they going to do? They're not going to do anything. They're going to get an ultimate onto Contracts, who's fine. You know? Jensen's gonna throw Daisy away, and they just get it for free. Haunter, great flash into them by Haunter. That actually makes this engage happen. This engage would not have happened if Haunter didn't flash there with zero hesitation. So all kudos to Haunter for making this happen. And now that it's happened, they are fractured, low from having taken Baron, and not in optimal position. Having impact in the very front was the only saving grace that keeps them from losing more. But that's absolutely worth it. A Baron for one kill on Smoothie, and it took a couple summoner spells to make it happen. That's absolutely worth it. Now the question is, how is C9 going to use that Baron? It's very early in the game. We see that top side is pushing, and bot side is pushing in. The 5 minute happened to try and get that turret, which TSM successfully did, but they're all low. And there's Jensen, even through the exhaust, is going to pick up that kill. It looks like, no, he actually flashes forward. That's going to be enough. Yep, that's it. Okay, so that's why it's a little risky to go for that turret play instead of going back regenning. The reason you don't want to do that is because the Baron is going to like buff all of the minions and you're going to lose any chance to knock down that turret. So the thinking is knock down that last outer turret before they can get back with the Baron buff. And that will give us a little extra gold in our pockets to try and defend the siege. But if you do that wrong, even slightly misplay the retreat and are just a little bit slow, this gets annihilated. They just went through two turrets, inner and inhibitor, and the inhibitor itself before they could even start positioning to defend the inhibitor. That's how quickly they can melt that when they have two infernal drakes and the baron buff minions this early in the game. That is so much damage. They're going to tear through your base. And it's just so risky. It's so risky. I get it. You got to try and mitigate the losses by getting that last outer turret gold back to your team. But it's so risky to do that. You're living on a knife's edge. And TSM snowballed the first two games of the series by walking on that knife's edge the whole time and threading that needle just perfectly. But man, live by the sword, die by the sword. This feels like a game where that's just not working out for them.
Execute perfectly to be able to win a fight when you're up that much in gold and you have the double infernal.
So that in game one with Haunters 1v1.
Okay. So the next Drake is coming out. It's another infernal Drake. This is going to be a triple infernal game. If C9 can get it, that's obviously insane for them. The vision is fairly evenly divided through the river right now. Impact being able to split push the top side is forcing TSM from being able to properly defend this vision. So right now, even though they didn't have strong vision before this point, they're able to really heavily invade right now and establish control. Now the control is only on this side because they haven't rotated all the way through yet, and they weren't able to sweep out all of the wards, so there is some vision remaining here in addition to the scuttle crab for TSM, but there's so much. Now look at the vision line for TSM, or for Cloud9. That's really good vision. Sure, there's a couple of spots here and there TSM has holes in it, but the initial defensive line for it is so pushed up, and they have a perfect opportunity to stay grouped to defend it by escorting this huge minion wave with the Baron buff into the inhibitor. And they get that extra gold of the inner turret from bottom lane. They have the perfect path to retreat. If it looks like they can't get this, just retreat right on back to Infernal Drake, which is exactly what they're doing right now. They're going to send a couple. They're actually going to stay grouped because Shen is doing such a good job of split pushing on the top side. He will continue to keep the pressure on, clear out that next wave, make it so that they have to deal with the wave crashing at this turret, the supers coming in here, Nautilus having to make sure Shen can't split push, whilst Shen takes blue buff, mind you. Oh my god, they're starving them of what little resources they have. And there's the triple Infernal Drake with a Cloud Drake to back it up so they can make sure they get proper positioning in those fights. Like, this is the lethal dragon composition. I know people badmouth air dragon, but Cloud Drake is so helpful for positioning. Just that little extra initial positioning, if you have a ton of infernals under your belt, makes those infernals so much more effective. It's effectively another amp to your damage because it makes sure that you can get it off efficiently.
One of the toughest parts about diving here as Haunter is smoothly.
So now they're going to send Impact into the bottom lane. You dive too far. He's going to again further extend their vision control. He's going to split push the bottom side because the Drake that's coming up is not the next important objective. The next important objective is the sooner spawning Baron. So they're all rotating top aside from Shen. Not looking for a fight, just looking to poke people away, regroup around this minion. They don't have the Baron buff anymore, but they do have a lot of gold in their pocket. They still have super minions streaming in here, so the pressure is going to naturally occur mid. The pressure is naturally occurring bottom, and look at how deep they're going, right? So they're trying to force this to happen, and I think Hanser's actually about to sort of put himself in a vulnerable position because nobody's following him over this, and nobody has like a huge teleporting gap close ability. So he's going to be kind of alone here. He is Nautilus, so he'll probably be fine. But while all this is happening, remember, this inhibitor's down, so mid lane's pushing on its own naturally. Shen can be here in an instant with his ultimate, and in the meantime is getting free damage, not just shoving in bottom lane. If you see through the actual YouTube thing. He's at the turret right now. He's getting damage on that turret. And as soon as it seems like he's needed, here comes the ultimate, coming right out onto Jensen. Jensen barely gonna survive, but thanks to the Shen ult he does, gives him more time with Biofrost. Biofrost is gone. Look at that, it's an ace for nothing! Are you kidding me? Oh my goodness, so sick! And Shen just teleports back to mid lane and is going to escort the minions through. They're going to run past the inhibitor turret and just end off of this. This is it. That was it. Look at the death timers. There's no way. The game's over. Are you kidding me? Are you kidding me? Cloud 9.
And we talk about what people remember.
Man. Holy smokes.
Those first two games they got smashed didn't happen. The reverse this, will be what happens.
This rookie con.
This feels like the first games felt for TSM. TSM had really good games in those first two games, and it felt strong. It felt okay at the very start of the game. There were micro advantages that slowly started piling up, but then they quickly snowballed out of control. And that's exactly what happened here. Cloud9 took those little advantages, and they snowballed way out of control with them. And that really, because this is going to Game 5 now, which we're about to do momentarily. So don't worry, we're not going to wait too long on this one. But I just want to say, we talked a lot in Game 3 about the mentality of Cloud9 after getting not just two losses right off the bat, but devastating losses. They got crushed. Not only coming back from that, but to come back from that and then have Game 4 crush them, this is going to destroy TSM's mentality coming into Game 5. It's effectively a best of one now in the series. This is for all the marbles to decide who's the best in North America. And TSM is coming off of losing what seemed like a locked-in series and starting to lose control completely by getting smashed in Game 4. So, let's get right into Game 4. Let's go ahead and